Let us start the discussion. Okay. Firstly, I just take few of the minutes to make a summary of the yesterday's discussion. Then we'll proceed with Atul's discussion, and then we'll try to have a question answer round based on the points we discussed yesterday and today. Okay. So yesterday we had a productive discussion. We discussed about the points which are not included in EIA, which may be about the answerability of the ACOs, about the industries which are not included, like nuclear energy, etc. About that, about the most important point, that is the monitoring part. The monitoring part of EIA is missing since 1994, since every notification. Then we talked about the post-facto clearance issue, and we talked about the limited scope of the EIA. Secondly, we discussed about the problems in the EIA framework in general, that it is a tool used by industries to earn profit at the expense of people's life and environment. Also, so in this discussion, we try to find out, if not EIA, then what, or how can we make the EIA more productive? So without wasting any time, I would like to Atul to please take over the stage. Now, before introducing Atul, before giving your presentation, I would like to say a few words about you. See, Atul is a student in the final year National Law University, and he has been playing a proactive role in many environmental and social issues. So I hand over the stage to Atul. Atul, you can start with your presentation.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. And thank you, Ankit ji, for that introduction. I'm just a law student. I don't have very much experience in environment in this arena, but I have only studied, that end in the environment law clauses, and I've helped Dr. Sandeep Pandey sir in drafting some petitions and all that, but nonetheless. So to begin with, yesterday our panelists had already, discussed the burning issues that is there, and the problems that is there with the new EIA draft in quite detail and in a very nuanced manner. And they had already covered most of the things. So what I would like to point today is, some small things that I noticed while preparing this slide, while comparing the previous EIA with the new one. So one thing that noticed that, the environment impact assessment norms that we had in India, was beset with loopholes since the beginning. I think we didn't have, very robust and good law on this front, because if you look at the previous EIAs that were there, since 1994, mostly they have the same issues and concerns, like wide discretion that the government had even in past EIAs also reserved wide discretion to define what is strategic projects. And then certain projects were development projects were again totally exempt from prior environment clearance. And that we had since 2006, there were certain industries where the investment was up to 50 crores, they were also exempt from environment clearance. And the other problem area was, that if you compare our legislations with some of the countries that have very good environment law norms, is that that deemed approval. And this is a provision that was not only there in the EIA 1995 and in the subsequent, deemed approval, that provision is also there in the many other environment, many other legislations concerning environment protection, for example, the Water Act. So the deemed approval is considered very problematic by those who are the experts in the environment law, because it is a kind of it rewards the violators because in our country we know that the system is the bureaucratic machinery is very very lazy and very slow. So for example, they have set a time limit for 60 days for giving the approval. And as we know that it is not strange that, you know, most of the time that approval does not come within the 60 days. Then that is, you know, considered a deemed approval. And now, as opposed to this, in other countries like United States, Canada, and European Union, they have deemed rejection. So if the authority is not giving consent within the time frame that has been set in the in their statutes, then it is considered deemed rejection. And then they have, you know, appeal mechanism and all of that. But we have the concept of deemed approval, and it was there in the EIA as well as in some other acts like the Water Act. And in the previous EIAs also, the publics were public consultation and lots of exceptions were there in the previous legislations as well. For example, the as you can see on the screen, the modernization of river value, it is exempt, you know, even in the new one, and the project located in the industrial estates. But what is problematic in the current EIA is that it has expanded significantly this list, and this categorization like A and B, B2, etc. is still there in the new EIA as well. And some other things that the discretion that was already discussed by our panelists yesterday, and the public consultation also. I mean, like public consultation, public is a very important stakeholder. I mean, in case of, and most of the historic experience shows that in many of the, you know, cases concerning, you know, very severe environment pollution, it has been the public that has come at the forefront in preventing that and taking preventive measures. And the post facto clearance, this again flies in the face of the various environment law norms and the international law conventions on environment protection issues. From Stockholm conventions to the Rio conference, the Johannesburg declaration. So, and here one thing, starting, I noticed that even though India is signatory to, has also ratified some of them, still, if you analyze most of our laws, they have been, brought into picture after some Protection Act 1986. That was brought in response to the, we had not there, because if you look into the precautionary principle, it was, it has been recognized in international law conventions pertaining to environment since very early. But only after the Bhopal gas tragedy took place, India passed legislation concerning, a holistic, it was not holistic per se, but still, they passed a legislation like in the nature of Environment Protection Act, 1986. And then, they still, it took them another almost years come up with to notify the environment impact assessment notifications finally in 1994. So that's, the whole of the, the whole intent and the object becomes questionable. The seriousness of successive governments that we had in India regarding the polluter pays principles that also our panelists, discussed yesterday. And the cognizance mechanism. On one hand, the public that is an important stakeholder has been excluded, but on the other hand, who are potential violators, they have been empowered to report the cases of violations. Generally it is the tendency is that people tend to hide their the failures, and so I was surprised at which violator would choose on his own violation to go and report the cases of the environment law violation, or if he has caused some significant pollution. And these provisions like exclusion of public from certain, they are, defense related or security related, because ultimately taking decisions, I personally believe that if people can speak, at least, at some, bare minimum level, public should be involved in consultation concerning the defense and security related projects as well. And if you look at the Indian Constitution, there are various provisions, especially if you look at the Article 51 AG, I mean, that makes it a duty of every Indian citizen to protect the environment. But if publics are, people are excluded from, reporting cases, from consultations in case of the impact assessment and all of that, is a violation of these important constitutional provisions. And these are the two cases that we mentioned in our article, in a draft article that we and Dr. Sandeep Pandey and recently. So, this was, this large case of that European Commission of India Limited case, if the local, it would have been a very massive, environmental hazard. And similarly, in the recent case, some of you must have read it in the news, the Sangli Highway project. So there, it was local, they were the authorities on which the, EIA relies for reporting the cases of violation. They had given a go-ahead for the chopping of this, this big tree, 400-year-old banyan tree. Project, but it were the local villagers who, along with some environmental activists, they campaigned whether to save the tree, and thankfully it has been saved now. And now one thing, the very good excuses that the governments not only in this law arena, that is the no-go zone for public discussion and all kind of these the public involvement.
I think Atul might have got disconnected. Atul, are you there?
Yes, I'm already there. Can you hear me? I saw that there was some disruption.
Yeah, actually, we can't see your presentation now. You got, disconnected.
Okay, just let me share it again. Yeah, so I was talking about sustainable foreign policy. Because it is very important, to fulfill the objectives of the sustainable development. Because ultimately we see that whether it is environment law or some other issues, excuses of in RTI as well, for example, this is there. There has active development, public engagement, not only in India, but all so that, because recently in our, when we launched towards a better is being caused to, that ecologically sensitive Himalayas due to the construction of the, highways and expansion of road projects there. And all in the name of that, being our armed forces to march in case of emergencies or confrontation with China. So and that's the issue. It is a very sensitive issue. So people generally refrain from, if the government invokes such excuses, then people refrain from talking about that much, because otherwise they risk being labeled as anti-national. So that's why it becomes very important to initiate debates and principal discussions on this level as well, that all over the world countries should focus on foreign policies, security related matters, and defense related projects that are sustainable. And for that, more than governments, I think it is the people that can achieve a lot. There should be people to people engagement between different countries, especially our neighbors in the current cases. And there should be, efforts of trust building. So therefore, this fear of, countries attacking each other or meddling in each other's affairs, that can be reduced drastically. And if that fear is allayed, then that fear or that psychosis of that realism, that arms race can also be reduced. So and most of our that sensitive, ecologically sensitive areas lies in the border areas, for example the Himalayas. So for that purpose, because now the that defense or the security matter has become a biggest that roadblock there. So for the protection of environment and for sustainable development, we should also be, you know, talking about the sustainable foreign policy and sustainable security and defense related issues. So that was it. The current scenario, we most of us are already aware of that recently the Karnataka High Court had extended the deadline till 7 September, the filing of, you know, public objections and comments there. And let's see what happens. So that was from my side, Ankit. Thank you.
Thank you, Atul. That was quite indeed an insightful presentation. So does anyone from the participants has any question from Atul? Okay. Atul, you talked about sustainable domestic politics. So I want to know more about it. What actually you mean by this sustainable domestic politics, and how it can actually be helpful in curing and allaying the EIA impact?
Yeah, the sustainable domestic politics or sustainable foreign policy, it's still a very, it's an idea. It's not been, talked much about, but because if our politics, revolves around, very nationalistic fervor, Zingoism and all of that, then, all issues are sidelined on matters of nationalism, national security, defense, integrity, sovereignty, and all of that. So to tackle that thing, for example, in case of as I mentioned in my talk, the Himalaya issue, the massive roads and highways that are being constructed, and in our, that campaign launched towards the better world that, our learned panelists had discussed, that, the government, that gave that excuse that, we need these roads and highways for the troops to march in case there is some confrontation with China. So, these are the policies, if there is a sustainable in the sense, that's, revolving around peace, not war, not the advocacy of war or zingoism or, hyper-nationalism. So, sustainable foreign policy or sustainable domestic policy, I meant that only. We can say that, kind of Gandhian, the incorporation of Gandhian philosophy, and by all political parties, and people should also be, made aware, at large scale, there should be public campaigns so that people are informed about, so that even if some politician is, being very hyper nationalist or Zingoist, people can reject them. So that is the, that was what I meant by, sustainable. It is an area not very explored, much by now. And it's still, at a very, it was a very nascent idea. I just thought, I should discuss it. But a lot can be, researched and, written about this. But thank you.
Okay, I think it is more on the lines of that, local area government, like the community model, which Sagar was discussing yesterday, that the people should take care about the environment, the rivers, the forest. Because if they take care by themselves, then the role of the central impact won't be there. And the people, they can fight against those industries which are trying to pollute their environment.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that, the communitarian approach that, our panelists talked about yesterday. And that's very important. But again, I would suggest again that we should adopt a mixed strategy, because if too much rely on, local government or that village level, we see that, corruption is there as well. We cannot say that if the corruption is there at higher authorities, then there is no corruption at, village, panchayat or these levels, because if you go into some village, people will tell that there, that Gram Pradhan, is corrupt and, he puts all his money that development, that comes for the development purposes, he misappropriates, embezzles, all of that. So, issues are here as well. So, there should be some monitoring mechanism. Decentralization is a welcome move, in every arena. That's what Gandhiji also advocated, but again, with proper monitoring, I would say, not just, be giving them total autonomy in case of environment, because then companies can also, these are very rich companies and powerful companies. People can be bribed. This chance is always there. So, it should be some robust mechanism. And like, even if we are giving them parts to the, you know, at village level, local level, then the monitoring should still be there. I mean, like centralized monitoring, I mean, some kind of should still be there. On both, if the decision making is happening at centralized level and decentralized levels, the monitoring should be there. I mean, some good faith and like impartial, that is impartial, and that does not have any like personal interest or concern there with the projects. So
there should be an independent body for monitoring.
Yeah.
Even yesterday's discussion or today's discussion, everyone of our eminent panelists, they talked about one thing, the monitoring part. The monitoring part is missing in that. So further, thank you, Atul, for the presentation. You actually discussed all the issues which are present EIA includes, which were, I think we didn't discuss yesterday. You compared our EIA, our policy with the foreign policies and how it is lacking in terms of government mandate. And second, about the post-facto clearance. Then you talked about the polluter pay principle that in India, the polluter can get away with paying a paltry fine. Then you talked about a weak cognizance mechanism. Then that in the present EIA, the citizens are somewhat excluded from reporting any disruption in the environmental norms. So that is quite worrisome. And lastly, you talked about sustainable foreign policy, sustainable domestic policy as a kind of a cure to have a strong EIA system. For the next, I would like to request Dr. Pihu Pardeshi, if she wants to say something on this regard.
Yeah, thank you. And that was a great presentation. Thank you, Atul, for that. I just wanted to highlight one and add one more point that I look at the disaster management angle also. So this is something which we need to recognize as Indians and as Southeast Asians, that 70% of all the disasters and all the natural hazards that occur in the world occur in Southeast Asia. And with the climate change occurring and with the kind of environmental devastation that we have already brought about, they are only going to increase. So even when we discuss, like we had discussed about the Chardham Highway project and all, wherever we are building roads for strategic importance, or we are saying that this road is required for defense purposes or development is necessary, we need to also bring into consideration that this is, if there is a landslide, if there is soil erosion, if there is deforestation, it is going to affect the peacetime as well as the wartime efforts. It is going to affect the general development as well as the any kind of strategic decisions that we are going to take at our fronts. So when these projects are brought about, we need to, there is a framework called Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction that came about in 2015. I think all that has to be integrated into our development projects. And from that lens, if we start looking at environment impact assessment also, so we are not just doing development sustainable developments. We need to integrate those sustainable development goals along with the disaster risk reduction goals. So our development is gentle and light on our environment, and it does not pose future problems. So when we say sustainable development, what we say is that we have present prosperity, but not at the cost of future's prosperity. So similarly, when we say disaster risk reduction, we are saying, okay, we want to develop, but not in a way which will maybe postpone the disaster, but it will come at a higher intensity. So there's a concept that has come about, which is called eco-DRR, which is eco-sensitive disaster risk reduction, where instead of building levees and bridges and walls, we are actually letting the river flow and trying to relocate as well as, or trying to do as only that much development that will not harm the natural flow of the river, or which will be harmonious with nature. So if those principles are also brought in environment impact assessment, and if we look at that if we look at development through that lens, then again, I mean, that is one more thing that we need to be careful of, because till now, if the disasters have not occurred, they are going to surely occur. And if we keep on neglecting these kind of impact analysis and all, I mean, we will be just caught by surprise. So I mean, that is just one bit of from my side that I wanted to add. Thank you
Dr. Pihu. That was quite actually a valid point you discussed. Basically, the conclusive points, like Sandhai Framework 2015 and Eco-DRR. I just have one question from your side. Like, if we talk about dams or if we talk about development, say hydroelectric projects, etc., then we are disrupting the river flow. And firstly, this point. And secondly, like, is this Eco-DRR, is it like the government policy, or I actually don't know much about the Eco-DRR. It's just give us a brief summary of this.
Yeah, it's just a principle. But basically what we are trying to do is disaster risk reduction is like a preventive phase. So disaster management cycle has four phases, where first you try to prevent the disaster or mitigate the disaster. Then even after that, some kind of flooding is going to occur. So you rescue, relief measures you take, and then you after that, in a long-term time, you do the recovery plan. And so and then again you start towards mitigation procedures. So that cycle continues. So every year we have floods. So how do we prepare best? How can we prepare a population best? Either by moving away from that flood prone areas, or just giving some kind of economic stability to the area so that people become more resilient towards disasters, or maybe some insurance package, whatever works best. So when we say Eco-DRR, what we are saying is we are using an ecosystem approach, where we say that the development has to be so integrated that even when we are developing, we are developing in such a way that the risk of that disaster occurring is reduced. So instead of bigger dams, we are only making smaller dams, so we are focusing on local economy. We are not looking at large scale projects which will hamper the whole ecosystem of the area, right? So the geographic landscape should not change, but it should only serve the purpose of, say, a cluster of villages. And from there, if we can have electric power, that's good. But we should not aim at, like we also talked about decentralized governance, that also can be part of Eco-DRR, where all our footprints, our ecological footprints is at a very local level. It does not say we don't have to draw water from long distant villages to bring into the city. We should be able to have local sources of water and electricity generation, so that the local geography is not so much affected. And the soil erosion does not take place, because the higher the dams we build, larger the dams that we build, it is going to affect the both upstream and the downstream areas, right? So why we build large scale dams is because it is cost effective. But then we have not ruled in the cost of the externalities, right? The labor and the displacement and the destruction that happens by after disasters. If we rule in, we will know that dam project, which is a large scale dam project, which looks so fabulous, is not actually sustainable. So what really works for people is smaller dams, which they can manage by themselves, you know, at local government level. And I agree with the fact that, you know, it has to be a mixed system where government and people and all are integrated, and there is there are checks and balances which work at which work for feedback as feedback systems. So basically Eco-DRR principle is that only, just trying to make a gentle and slow development rather than fast economic growth. And in harmony with nature, that is what. So using your own ecosystem for disaster risk reduction, because ecosystem has its own services that it provides. You don't have to always have market products for getting services, right? Ecosystem also provides the services which we need to rule in when we look at services and costs. That I hope I have made some points clear.
Actually, you have made the point some clear and actually raised more questions for me. Firstly, like you're talking about development, small development, big development. I think by that you are saying the small development which has a less impact on the environment and the major project which have more impact on the environment, right? Then I want to say that if you talk about science, okay, science is quite contradictory. Like some people will say the science is saying, okay, this project will be harmful for the environment. And the another group from the industrial proponent will say, okay, the science is saying this project will have minimum impact. So there's quite a contradiction in that because there's no established science if we talk about the environmental impact. So can you like give your views, like what should be the solution for that part?
So impact on what? That is what we have to see. Na? I mean, the environment impact is one thing, then social impact, health impact. There are so many other impacts. Industry saying it will be that impact is not much. Or, I mean, if we can talk with an example, maybe. So if we say that, okay, there is a nuclear power plant that wants to come, then we need, are we ruling in all the possibilities, all the, of the risks? We are saying, okay, India is a developing country. That's how every discussion starts. And that's why we need power. We need to manufacture. We need services. Hence, industry will say that, yes, this project is very helpful and it will have only a positive impact. But what is the trade-off? At what cost? Is it destroying the local livelihoods, the local fisheries? Is it polluting the marine environment? So all those has to be monitored and counted. I mean, unless we have those monitoring systems, that impact evaluation will not be a fair evaluation, isn't it? So I mean, so people's development. Yesterday also I pointed out that they want to stay in harmony with nature because their rural livelihoods or their livelihoods in general depend on ecosystems, right? If there is a lake, they want to fish and they sell that fish, then they want fish to survive. They don't want the fish to die totally in one shot. So they will give time for spawning. You know that cultural practices are in such a way that the fish consumption will reduce during the time in the season of their mating so that the fish count can replenish, right? So that kind of local decision making, rural people or the people whose livelihood is dependent on that system or ecosystem they will be sensitive to it and they will act accordingly. But industry, who doesn't care about fish industry or the fish based livelihoods, they will say that no, we want the water and we will release our effluents here so that the cost is lesser, but we will give you electricity. But so that's where the what are your priorities? Na? Is it your local livelihood is a priority or just generating power, which anyway may not reach the villages? It may actually reach the other industries or say defense sector or other some city it may be powering. So that is where our priorities have to be counted. Have I answered?
Actually, that's a valid point. People should be given power. People should be given say in the development projects, and they are the better judges of their topography of the resources, and they should allow the project to permit or not. And for that, I would like to have thoughts of Dr. Lumna that what she says sees the solution of the of this EIA impact and like what the solution of EIA, what is the stronger body should be there or not.
Yeah, hello to everyone.
Dr. Lumna, you're not audible.
Oh, really? Now? Is it okay now? Am I audible?
That is better, right?
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay, thank you. See, very important points Atul has brought and even Pihu has brought in. So, Sandeep ji also, when we were concluding yesterday, the main purpose of today's meeting is about, coming up to a draft that socialist party is going to submit to the government, our own objections, because just Tuesday, I think, is the last date as per Sagar yesterday. So we will submit, my proposal is that we submit all our objections in bullet points. Okay. Some very, of course, we will take in, I too was very new to the term of eco-DRR that PIHO has presented today. So surely we will absorb that into our, I propose that that should be absorbed into one of our recommendations. And many of Atul's points also, of course, they were reiterations, but it needs more and more reiteration. So the what I want to tell is that quick 2-3 recommendations, new ones from my side. And after that, we'll have to consolidate everything. See, now we all know that in environmental degradation, first thing is that the people and the environment both are supposed to be the heart of an EIA notification. But we all feel that the main things, the environmental protection and the people's protection, these two are absent. They are not at the heart of the EIA 2020. That's all is a basic gut feeling. So now, see, it when as long as we keep telling that no, the environment should be protected and the well-being of the people should be protected, there's nobody to listen. And even if you tell in any form, they're not going to listen because it's capitalism driven and etc. Now the point here is the environmental degradation is not just bad for the livelihoods on the ecosystem. We have to drive them the point when Delhi shut down, all the capitalists were harmed. When the pandemic came, all the capitalists were harmed in the world and in India, everywhere. So the point to be stated upright first is environmental degradation actually hampers, to use their own words, they want growth and development. They rarely use well-being of people. They use only growth and development. Whereas we conscious people, we want well-being. So if we start off by telling that environmental degradation is bad for growth, bad for development and bad for well-being, so maybe we attract some attention of everybody, you know, because it is bad. They are seeing it, but they want to close their eyes because there's a lot of money involved, a lot of power involved, a lot of the ruling, I mean, the donations to the political parties, a lot of things involved. So I feel that our opening should be like this so that we actually catch hold of them right at where they want us to be leaving them, telling that they want growth and development. But we tell them that no, degradation is actually hampering growth, development and well-being. We will not forego our words also. Now, the most worrisome thing is, of course, the citizen exclusion. That's, you know, it's ridiculous. So up front, we are going to tell that that has to go. So in our bullet points, even that has to be there. Now, one very important point out of experience I want to just bring here. In the numerous cases that we go towards the NGT, NGT is the chief one, it has a set of acts to be implemented. One of the chief acts is Environmental Protection Act. And this EIA notifications flow out of that act. So what we are telling is that whenever we go, we take to the NGT or to any platforms, you know, the high courts or the NGT, that these are the violators. The state itself is a violator. The state itself is giving wrong NOCs and permissions. So when we go to the NGT, you know what they do? NGT immediately forms a committee, or they form a committee, or they say something. But what happens is that committee is constituted out of the violators. I went to the, we people go to the NGT telling that the state has violated or the state has connived with a private agency. And what the NGT is doing is the committee which it constitutes to examine the violation consists of all these violators with whom I went with a prayer. So ultimately, whether it's the High Court or whether it is the NGT or any other judicial body, the people, the agencies against which we have a complaint are sitting in a committee, becoming the eyes of the judiciary. So that's very worrisome, actually, you know. So I told that judge upfront, my own complainants against whom I have come to you for justice are in the committee to judge their own violation. So do you think I mean, what am I expecting? He said, no. See, they didn't do when you told them, no, represented them. No. So we will make them do. That is why we put them in the committee. So all these sort of, how long can we carry on like this? How many more years do we have the violators themselves sitting in the committees and examining? So where's the independence, both of the, whether it's High Court or the EM? Well, I mean, that also, I mean, I think it should be a part of this. And of course, the EDR and one important, cumulative projects. See, in a city, you have 24 flyovers coming at the same time. and it is not having any environmental clearance. You know why? Because they broke into projects. They broke, same as what Sandeep has raised in the article about the, and that the lady, you know, who very, very wonderfully put across Chardham to us, the Chardham project. I don't recollect her name. So,
Malika.
Malika?
Yeah.
Malika, yes. Yeah. So, Malika has said, she opened it up so wonderfully to all of us. So, there also what they did, they divided it into various roads so that it overrides the EC necessity at all. So, the community projects is a very important thing that we'll have to raise. So, my recommendation is that, my proposal is that we bring all these in bullet points so that it's easily readable and digestible for the for people at large. And also, we can see which of these are going to be accepted by them. Because this has to go. They are going against the constitution when they say that the citizen can't complain. So these things out and right, they have to go. And for us, the remaining, all the things that we are asking also are, of course, very much within for the growth, development, and well-being. I think we have to sing that song for them. And that's all. I think that quickly we'll have to come up to the bullet points and represent. And over to you all, Sandeep Ji, Guru, and so many others, Ramachandra Ji, Sanjay Kumar.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lubna. You raised some valid points. When you said about growth, development, and well-being, so I think development is something which is misunderstood. When we say about development, we say, okay, the present thing won't regress. Okay, the present environment or the present environment or present status quo won't regress. But actually, development is what is leading is more on the industrial side. And if you talk about the environment and societal side, we are regressing. So the definition of development is not clear. It is not clear to the government. And yeah, we should address that as a cumulative effort. We should address that. So we discussed actually a lot of issues with the present EIA. And also that the issue with the EIA structure itself, like when you were saying about that, if you go to court and complain about the present industry, then they form a committee. And in that committee, they include members who are actually the violators. So how can we serve a justice? So I want to ask a question from our eminent panelists. What is the solution? That how can we get above this? Because it has been so many years, as Dr. Lubna has rightly put out, and we are still beating around the same bush. So anyone can take this question, anyone of our eminent panelists. Dr. Sandeep, you want to say something? So you're on mute, Dr. Sandeep.
So let me say something like sir corrects his mic. So, you know, the question of the violators being in the same panel, you know, for deciding, all of that, it's a clear case of violation of the principle of natural justice. I mean, that's very part and parcel of both the administrative law and constitutional law. So, this should not happen. Because one cannot judge his own, one cannot be, a judge in his own case. So that's what, you know, the principles of, natural justice is all about. So I think this should be objected to, and there must be some mechanism, you know, to object to the violators, you know, present and deciding, the violation of their own cases. So I think, it should be looked into, how that can be objected to.
I just want to add to this. I think I don't know exactly how legally that objections we can raise, but in any fair discussion there, we have to include all the stakeholders of that project, and stakeholders meaning people, also civil society organization, NGOs, government bodies, industry partners, whoever is being affected by the project, whether they are benefited or impacted negatively. All have to be included. So that is one point. Maybe we can say that, okay, you want to keep the violators because, okay, it has to be a negotiation finally. It's not that it's just, we need to find a middle path somewhere and see what are the trade-off, what are the costs and benefits. And hence the committee has to include at least say 5 representatives from the people who are affected and who may be neutral, and then maybe a judiciary, maybe an academician, things like that. If we can propose that, I think that will be really helpful. The violators are anyway going to be there. Their interests are also being served. So at least that that much we can demand.
No, I want to just let you all know, when the judge included the officials who actually gave permissions to them, and I showed the permissions, and I told, when they are there, when you can have them, then you have me on the committee. That was my argument. So let me at least push, because what happens is, when the violator and the officials are there in the committee, what they're doing practically, what we're seeing is, each time the hearing comes, they're telling, we need 2 more weeks to submit the report. We need 4 more weeks to submit the report. So it's going on and on, because it's in their hands now, you know, and the judge is not taking them to task. So what happens is, when the, if the violator can be there, then the petitioner is also there. At least the petitioner being in the committee will push them. No, please submit the report, submit, and we can actually put forward what is happening inside the committee. So there's no fairness over there, you know. So I think, as a because no party is raising all these points, you know. So maybe as a political party, we put this also in a bullet point. That's my proposal here. So it's going to be with the group decision.
So can I say that all the stakeholders, that the industrial, the industry people, the rural people, the people who will be impacted, the NGO, the academician, they should have an equal say, firstly in the environmental impact assessment part, like the ACO we were discussing. I think that these people don't have a say in that. Only the agency, which is of the government, they prepare this thing. But the people don't have a say in that. Secondly, the monitoring part. The monitoring part is amiss in the present EIA and all the EIAs before that. And there should be a monitoring committee separately. We should include all these people, the people who are being affected, again, the industry part, the NGO part, the academicians, everyone. And lastly, in case of any violation, if any committee has to be formed, it has to include all this, all the stakeholders and all the people. Can I say this thing?
I think so. One more important as part of this is, who is the mediator of that discussion? It's very difficult to find a very neutral mediator, but I think, you know, like, we bid for these things, that maybe it is anonymous and people don't know, so that they cannot bribe them. Who is mediating the discussion? Because that, if there is a neutral mediator, that person will not be influenced by looking a powerful person. And I mean, some such kind of strategies have to be devised so that a fair negotiation, a fair deal, fair discussion takes place. So, that is where we have to also evolve into. So I don't know how to demand that, but because... purchasable.
When a proposal is goes for environmental clearance at any stage, at the MOEF level or at the state AC level, what's happening is that the EIA, Environment Impact Assessment, and the Environment Management Plan, EMP, as per rule, they are formed by the accredited institutions. And the accredited institutions have a set over there. There's a form A, there's a form B, and other things. And that has to be filled in. Yes, no, this, that, parameters, that, you know, it's like that. So there, the first step itself is about a accredited institute. And what happens when he's lying, when he's telling where there's a water body, he says no, or he shifts it. What happens to the accredited institute? That it is silent. And second thing, at the EIA state itself, the reporting, why should the reporting be done by an accredited institute? Where at that stage itself, even if there is some institute like that, then who are the people involved? No, it is just what the information furnished by the project proponent that gets into it, and they submit it to the assessment authority and they upload it to the MOAF website. This is what is happening. So it is so mechanical type, you know. It is not about looking at the ground, looking at the niceties and well-being. It's not that way. It's about how to push through the project. That's it.
So if I talk about EIA reporting system, if I include the stakeholders and also the people who will be affected by this in the EIA drafting, in the EIA assessment itself,
yes,
then I think that issue can be resolved, right? Yeah, assuming that
Sagardhara, the... Sagardhara 2007 itself, Sagardhara Rajamani, yesterday, as he said, they have been pointing this out since when they resigned from the government committee, telling that the impacted have to be consulted, impacted have to be actually assessing the environment impact. The impacted have to be doing that, not a certain company or not the project proponent. That's what they have been suggesting, and that's a very important observation. And of course, I think we should endorse his recommendation in full. And apart from that, Socialist Party should tell that these are all our bullet points for the recommendations. I think that is how we should go about. But I leave it to the group call.
I'd like to add one more thing. So, for example, we should be also be, you know, this provision should be there that if people who are impacted, if they on their own are not able to, even if they are given the right, for example, if, they make some modification and they say that, people belonging to this particular area where that development project is going, only they can report. So, and if those people are not capable, for some reason, they don't know. So on behalf of them, there should be, we have PIL, some mechanism should be there that if not those people, then on behalf of them, some activist or like some other group, should be empowered to report on behalf of them.
Okay. Yeah, see, the government is choosing accredited institutions, but not accredited NGOs or accredited activists, okay? So this anti-activist atmosphere. So what I'm telling is that yesterday, if you have heard one of the recommendations of Sagar's, it is about an informed decision and informed being in an informed position. So that is imperative upon the government to keep the people, local people informed as to what is happening in their own area. That is where this like a self-rule or Swaraj or the decentralized part of the government, it's constitutional. It's not, and now we are not speaking from somewhere else. We are speaking from the constitution itself, that when the locals should know what is happening, first of all, in that. In most part of India, the locals don't even know that such a project is coming in their area. Suddenly somebody is digging there, then we come to know, oh, somebody is digging here, so maybe it has some approval. So this is the point where it comes that the people have to be informed totally in detail as to what's going to happen to their area. And then it's so easy nowadays, even after being informed, they are being bought in, they are buyed, telling that land pooling here, by you are going to get a developed plot. So you give so many acres, you will get so many square yards. See, look at the bargain. In the name of development, they will tell your area is going to be your plot in 1 acre. If you're getting some square yards of plot, it's a developed plot. So that is equal to this. They are gullible. And I don't know, really. Sandeep, she should tell something.
Yeah, so this point was there in Sagar Dhara's recommendation also, that the local body, the Gram Sabha, should have the right to approve the project.
Yes.
So, in fact, they are the, actually, instead of having any activists or NGOs, it is the local elected body which should actually commission the EIA instead of the project implementer. And they should have the final say in whether the project should go ahead or not.
Yes.
Yeah. This is there in Sagar Dhara's thing.
Mm.
Yeah. In addition to that, if you also feel that the even state government and the rights are being violated now, that it's a federal, this EIA draft is against the federal system also. It says very clearly the committee, if the state government cannot nominate the members, central government can nominate the members on their own, actually. That's also what it says. That means and most of the projects are coming under the national importance. I mean, it says the 100-kilometer aerial distance from the borders, line of control, can be in the national importance. That means state cannot have any say. Most of the northeast states, most of the states will fall under the 100-kilometer aerial distance, actually. That's be who or somebody can correct if my assumption is wrong, actually. It's like so projects like Kudangulam or any projects also will come under the national importance, actually, where there is no need to have any consultation also.
So there are some more people here. I see Professor Ramchandran is there, and Sanjay Sharma was there. Would they like to add anything? No, I think they have left.
No, they're there. Ramchandran is there. Sanjay Kumar is there.
Okay, no problem. We should start winding it up because people for the next meeting are joining. So Ankit, you have enough points to draft something to be submitted to the ministry?
Yes, sir. I have most of the points. I just have one last question. If anyone can answer, like if I talk about the impact of a particular project, then there's a science behind it. Okay. And as an engineer, I would say that we have limited knowledge about the national, about the environment, the impact and project can make. Okay. So my calculations can be wrong. So in my calculations, I can say, okay, the project will be minimal, but after the project has been proposed, it has been established, and after a few years, I realize, okay, I am wrong. So what can be solution of that? Like, what is the science, established science? Is there any established science behind all of this that we can follow, which can actually determine the impact of a project so that there's no accidents in the future?
Yeah, if I may say, the points that Sagar raised yesterday about an acceptable impact and unacceptable impact. You think so? Yeah. This is one of his points. So that is what he was asking, that this should be defined. So now nothing is defined there. And that will answer your question. Now, you know, the effluents coming out of the thermal, the gaseous things coming out of the thermal, the expanding that point is what was my concern yesterday. See, when we are doing the assessment, we are talking about the effluents. We are measuring about the effluents, gaseous or liquid, okay, or solid, okay. But my question was that we want to be clear about not just the effluents that are coming out in three forms, but also about talking about the impact on the surface water, the groundwater, the soil, and the atmosphere. So when we talk about these, see, the impacted are these, apart from the human beings and the life, other forms of life, it is these natural resources that are impacted. So how are these going to be impacted due to those effluents? This match will create what is the acceptable impact and unacceptable impact is my submission. That was what I was trying to drive it yesterday also. I don't know if I have made myself clear.
I just want to add here. One thing is that, okay, maybe one person, maybe one agency cannot do a complete assessment and cannot envisage a complete impact. And that's why maybe there should be a lot of third party independent analysis, research, and ongoing monitoring. Yes, there may be some unforeseen impact. And then that's why the regular monitoring will quickly detect it, and then we can mitigate it right when it starts. There would always be something which will change, maybe because of climate change, maybe because demographic change, some such thing will keep coming up because there is another industry beside that. Because even now, we impact analysis, what we are doing is only for one project, but what is the cumulative impact of five different industries, we don't know. So when that happens, at least if the monitoring is in its place, we will know what was the baseline data, what is per year increase in pollutants, or whatever is the change in the species diversity, whatever we find, at least we can say, okay, no, this has to stop and this has to rectify, and then we can take immediate measures. So these are two things, regular monitoring as well as independent research teams, various multiple teams working on it. If we just have one time, one person doing it, obviously we will miss out on many things. So that's from my side.
Yeah. I think Mr. Panalal Surana has something to say. Sir, you can speak.
And Sanjay Sharma is there again, and Professor Ramchandran, if they want to say anything, they can also contribute.
I want to say Sandeep ji and other friends, hello. It's a good discussion, but one of the points which I just wanted to add was leaving it alone many times to just Gram Sabha will not suffice, Sandeep ji. Because many times Gram Sabha, I live very close to the village, in fact, I'm living in villages these days. Even Gram Sabha is subjected to manipulation, so there has to be a bit more into it than just giving. Asking Gram Sabha to take the final decision. This is just from my side. Thank you.
So what, apart from Gram Sabha, sir, what is your suggestion?
It has to, Gram Sabha can be just one of the representations, one of the representatives in the process. There have to be other people too, which has been discussed here sufficiently well.
Okay. ठीक है. I think we can now start winding up, so that you know, we can begin with the next set of people who have come to discuss the Bihar elections. Anything else?
No,
Ankit, do you have anything else that you want to discuss?
I think Dr. Panala Surana, Mr. Panala Surana wants to say something. He raised his finger. So I just want to hear his viewpoint on this.
Okay.
I just want to know when our meeting start. When would it start?
Okay. Okay. So we can wind up the first meeting now.
Okay. I just say the concluding remarks. So thank you all the eminent eminent panelists who took time to come here and discuss about the EIA, and we really had a good productive discussion, and I'll try to compile all your points and share the notes with all of you. So thank you all from my side.
Thank you.
It was not only you share, but you also submit it to the ministry, Ankit.
I'll do that.
Because tomorrow is the deadline, na? So first share a draft with all of us.
The deadline.
And then on behalf of Eco-Socialism Front, and with all our names who were there as part of the discussion, you can submit that memorandum to the ministry.
So Is it on the party's behalf, for Sandeep ji?
Pardon?
Is it on the party's behalf?
Yeah. I mean, Eco-Socialism Front is one of the wings of the party.
Okay.
Working on the environmental issues.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. Thank you, Dr. Lubna.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.